for you to kiss your fingers or to kiss your thumbs and to rub your eyes, you will never suffer from any ailment in your life. Mawdu'at, mawdu', hadith mawdu', fabricated, la aslalahu, as Ibn al-Jawzi mentions inside his al-mawdu'at, and many of the ulama have collected this wording. All fabricated statements, that when you hear his blessed name, to kiss your thumbs and to rub it upon your eyes, there will be no ailment, no sickness inside your eyes, is a fabricated lie attributed to the blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is Ahmad Raza Khan al-Barelwi. This is their supreme leader. This is their ultimate leader. This is their great saint, the great sheikh that they follow, they inspire to. That's their attribute to themselves, that we are al-Barelwiyun. That's what they attribute to themselves, of following this individual through his life. And what are the roots of this individual? They call him Allah Hazrat, the great blessed individual. And even himself, he says, don't call me by the name of my father. He says, call me Abdul Mustafa. Call me the servant of Mustafa. That's not the name given by his parents or his grandfather. He changes and says, call me the servant of Mustafa. This is not allowed in Islam. We are not the servants of Mustafa. We are the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best names in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are Abdullah and Abdul Rahman, not Abdul Mustafa. None of the companions ever changed the name to Abdul Mustafa. No individual changed his name to Abdul Mustafa, to be the servant of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thus you find this individual, many of the ulama have collected, either had Shia roots, strong family Shia roots, like you find a Qadiani background. One amongst his teachers was the brother of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani, used to teach this individual. They believe this individual is infallible. That's what they believe. This individual never ever made mistakes. Allah's pleasure lies with the Prophet's pleasure. And the Prophet's pleasure lies with the pleasure of Raza. Like what you find, the grant of the creation is Ahmad Raza. You are the one who removes my difficulties, Ahmad Raza. Who gives me, who has given. Whatever was given, you have given, Ahmad Raza. In both worlds is your support. Yes, help me, Shah Ahmad Raza. In Hashr, when there will be the heat of Qiyamah, hide and cover me, Ahmad Raza. When the tongues become dry of thirst, give me a drink from Kawthar, O Ahmad Raza. Help accompany me inside my grave and in resuscitation on the day of Hashr. You are the one who removes my difficulties, Ahmad Raza. You are the giver and I am your receiver. I am yours and you are mine, Ahmad Raza. Pure kufr, pure shirk, that's what it is. This is what they attribute to this individual that you find. Likewise, he says to his own followers to praise him, and he highlights himself. At times he uses, this is supposed to be a great scholar, a great reviver. He calls himself a dog. Why should someone listen to you, O Raza? Dogs like you roam around in thousands. No one asks about you and no one cares about you because the dogs like you are numerous. I am the dog. Hadaiq Bakhshish, page number 5. This is supposed to be a great spiritual leader. No real scholar will downgrade himself and say, I am a dog. Anal kalb. I am a dog. And there's many dogs that roam around the streets. His various blunders are documented. Wasiyat Sharif that you find, what he says is his wasiyah, his legacy, that when I die, this is what you need to do upon my life. Bring chicken biryani, bring kebabs, bring firni, bring cream soda, bring iced milk, buffalo milk on my grave. Bring it on my grave, is what he writes. So this, what you find these celebrations around them, don't think they're strange. A dead man is saying that when I die, bring it to my grave. For who? Who's going to eat that food? And thus you find Urs Sharif, the 11th day that you find Yarmi Sharif that they believe in. Go and study the history of Yarmi Sharif, because they attribute to Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, wa huwa bari, he's free from what they attribute to him. They said that he used to celebrate the birthday of the Prophet Muhammad on the 12th of Rabiul Awal. He was vigilant of that. So the messenger blessed him with what? Yarmi Sharif. Gave him the 11th. That's the day for you, Peer Abdul Qadir Jilani. Did the Prophet Muhammad, when the death of his blessed daughters, did he ever offer Yarmi Sharif? Did he ever offer it? When Hamza, his uncle, died, did he offer Yarmi Sharif? When a number of his companions died, did he ever offer Yarmi Sharif? Did he say to his companions, bring food together, let us pray upon our blessed companions, let us call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them? Did he say that? Did he not have the means? Did he not have the ability? Did he have a lack of love towards his own daughters? Did he have a lack of love towards Hamza? Did he have a lack of love towards his own blessed uncle? Did he have a lack of love towards his blessed companions? So now for some reason you seem to have a more better love and approach towards the people you need around you. These people are individuals, destroyed the deen. These words may sound very, very harsh. And we find that these people, they try to attribute that these people, they don't love the messenger. These Wahhabiyun, these Ahlul Hadith, these Salafiyun, they don't love the messenger. They're Qasirin. They're deficient in their love towards the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what they try to highlight. We are the real lovers. We are the real people who have that real love towards him. You know, as a side point, if you go and study, that if it was allowed to build the tomb of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because according to their incorrect belief that you find, manzara qabri wajabat lahu shafa'ati, hadith munkar, whoever visits my grave, it becomes incumbent upon me to intercede for that individual. Likewise, whoever man hajja walam yazur qabri faqad jafani, whoever performs hajj and doesn't visit my grave has given disrespect towards me. Hadith mawdu, hadith munkar. Likewise, whoever comes to Medina and doesn't pray for 8 days, doesn't offer the 40 prayers, has not fulfilled the rites. These are all ahadith which are rejected by the ulama. Mr. Tahir al-Qadri, doctor, he highlights inside a dream, it is emotion, that's all they work upon, emotions. Begins to weep and begins to cry. Aqa came to me, the beloved one came to me. He came to me in a dream. He came where? To Pakistan. He came in a dream to you. And he came in front of me and he complained to me. And he said that the ulama of Pakistan have not respected me in a proper manner. They haven't taken care of me, and now I've come to you. And I'm putting the responsibility upon you. That is your task and your job to take care of me. My food, my drink, and my return. And look at his foolishness. Return ticket to fly back to Medina. The Quran says, Subhanalladhi asra bi abdihi layla min al masjid al haram ila al masjid al aqsa. He has to fly back on what? PIA? Saudi Arabian Airlines? You have to organize his ticket flight back to Medina. Wretched individual. That's what you call Gustakhi Rasul. That's what you call Gustakhi Rasul. To say he needs a ticket to go back to Medina. How did he come to you in the first place? How did he come to you in the first place? Weeping away in your dreams. And then he tries to highlight, you don't understand my dreams. Of course you don't understand your kufr and your shirk. Tries to pretend. أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ لَهُمُ الْبُشْرَى فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. He tries to hide behind this verse. Indeed, the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no fear, no regret upon them, no grief upon them. لَهُمُ الْبُشْرَى, they have a glad tidings inside this dunya. He says, this is my bushra. This is my glad tidings given to me. These are the glad tidings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what he believed in. And then some years later, you find can't make up his mind, can he? He's cutting a cake with a Christian priest. It's all one way. It's all one religion, Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism, whatever it may be. We are brothers cutting a cake with your Christian brothers. Clapping as well. Clap. Hurry, clap. Holding the candle as well. Go and visualize it for yourself. That's your great sheikh. That's his real belief of kufr. Pure kufr. That's what it is. And to say that he's a spiritual individual, or to defame us, you don't believe in the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who says we don't believe in the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We don't believe in the way that you believe in the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To do silly things, excuse expression, do stupid things, and to say that's a sign of a wali. To lie naked on the streets and say that's a wali. To eat leaves from the tree and say that's a wali. That's what they believe. That these people, ponjgen call Allah they call. That's what they are. You don't understand. You don't understand nothing about these people. What do you mean you don't understand nothing about these people? Man walking about naked on the streets. He's a saint of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I saw a man with my own eyes. With my own eyes walking around his underpants. Some months later, they built a great big tomb, a great big shrine. Said it wasn't like you, some stingy individual from the UK. He was a kind individual, built this tomb. Nanga Baba. A man I saw him with my own eyes walking naked on the streets, just his underpants. Everything for them is Sharif. Ajmer Sharif. You can't get to Ajmer Sharif. What should you do then? Send us a £50 check, isn't it? And we send you some of the dust for blessings of the shrine. We'll book your hotels when you come. Gangol Sharif. Bari Imam. And now around the corner, isn't it? We've got it, isn't it? Gangol Sharif around the corner now, isn't it? Getting ready to bury the saint and their peeves there. Where's the Sharif anyway? Everything can become Sharif for you. There's only three blessed places that Muslim travels to. Masjid al-Haram, the Masjid of the Prophet Muhammad, and Masjid al-Aqsa. Likewise, you find all types of kufr and shirk that begin to take place. Washing their shrines and their graves with milk. Go to Data Darbar, go to Lahore. Go to Lahore and visualize it. They washed the man's grave with milk. With milk, Hindu rituals. Cover it with milk, wash it with milk. And say this is supposed to be some form of tabarruk, some form of blessings. Whereby the Prophet Muhammad said, send Ali towards the end of his life, any grave that you find, beyond a hand span, dismantle it, break it apart. That's what he said to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He didn't say build great big tombs. You heard about a 40 foot tomb? Which man is 40 foot long? How can it be a 40 foot tomb that exists? But for them, they'll travel, exert their efforts to come to these shrines and to rub their heads upon these shrines, dance on these shrines, smoke drugs on these shrines, the ultras of haram action in these shrines, to mesmerize the masses. This is ways of getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you just sit there. They allowed their followers to dance in front of them. Did the messenger ever allow any companion to dance in front of him? Did he ever allow any messenger to kiss his feet? But for you, it's allowed for people to kiss your feet because we can't understand the Sharia. It's allowed for women to touch your hands because we can't understand the Sharia. No strange woman ever touched the blessed hand of the Prophet Muhammad, never in his life. But for you, it's allowed because you have special privileges that have been given to you. And likewise, they believe that you can visualize the Prophet Muhammad openly, not just in a dream. We believe Ahl Sunnah in a dream. Man ra'ani fil manam faqad ra'ani. Whoever sees me in a dream has indeed seen me. If you know what the shama'il, you know what the khuluk of the Prophet Muhammad is or are. But these people, they believe, they take it a step further. You can visualize him with your naked eye. You can visualize him openly. He can come in front of you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's what their creed and their belief is. And this all goes back to the pinnacle point of Mawlidun Nabi, the birthday of the Prophet Muhammad. They try to say it's only sunnah, it's only muakkada, but it's a pinnacle point of their aqa'id. If you don't believe in the birthday of the Prophet Muhammad, you're anta kharij, you're away from Ahlul Sunnah. You are no longer part of Ahlul Sunnah. That has become the symbol of their belief. You believe in Mawlidun Nabi, you are a true believer. And my simple words to these individuals, one simple word that I challenge these individuals, bring me one simple hadith, one single hadith, and I'll even open up the doors, bring a fabricated hadith, a weak hadith from the Sunan, bring it to me, whereby the Prophet Muhammad specifically said, don't forget to celebrate my birthday. Don't bring me, I was born on a Monday, I fast on a Monday, I fast on a Thursday, the gates of paradise are open on Monday or on a Thursday. Or bring the verse from the Quran, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِي فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُ هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Let us rejoice in this blessing. They say this blessing is referring to the blessing of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ulama of tafsir mentioned the siyak of the ayat of rejoicing is the blessing of the Quran and the blessing of the Sunnah. There is no clear-cut hadith. There is no clear-cut hadith. There is no hadith that exists. But they want to play on the emotions of people to say that this is the real love, the real devotion. Remember, everything about his blessed life has been documented. The way he urinated, the way he laughed, the way he wept, the way he talked, the way he slept, the way he kissed his wife, the way he done everything inside his life. Billahi alaykum. If every single thing has been documented, every single book of hadith, why is there not one single hadith? If I'm Gustakhi Rasul, if I'm blaspheming against the messenger, we spend all our life reading for his sunan, all our life reading for his ahadith. Ulama of ahadith, ulama of ahadith spend all of their life searching to find the statements of the Prophet Muhammad. All of a sudden, you found it. All of a sudden, you found it. And even more than that, you found it before Abu Bakr. You found it before Umar. You found it before Uthman. You found it before Ali. Were they too busy that you found his birthday and they never found his birthday? Does it make sense to you? You found it, they never found it. And likewise, the rest of the companions. Bilal, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, after the demise of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stopped giving the adhan. You want to play on people's emotions? Bilal, stop giving the adhan. He said, كيف أؤذن? How can I carry on when I come to ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, wa Rasulullah is no longer in front of me. He's no longer in front of me. I can't say these words anymore. Stop giving the adhan. Only on two occasions in his life did he ever come back and give the adhan. And all of the companions, they wept when he heard the adhan. Wa'antum juhal. Before the adhan, you begin to give the rood. Did Bilal ever give the rood before the adhan? Did he ever give them the rood before the adhan? Ever in his life? Do you love the messenger more than Bilal? Do you love him more than the messenger? Do you? You don't. It's a false practice. Before the Adhan, read the Durood. Which hadith is it? Which hadith does it exist in? You admit it's a false hadith. And you want to show that you love the messenger more than Bilal. You love the messenger more than the companions. You're liars. You're liars. That's what you are. In your face, you're liars. There's no doubt about that in my life. The biggest liars you are. On the day of judgment, the messenger will say to you, Suhtan, Suhtan, be off, be off. You are liars. You are people who attributed to me words that never existed. You attributed practices to me that never existed. You are people who attributed these false liars. That's what will be said to these individuals. There's no doubt about that. There's no time to chew our words anymore. People want to say that we chew our words about these individuals. Likewise, you find the concept of hazard wa nazar. Attendance. They believe that the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam attends their gatherings. So when they have these celebrations, they tell people to stand up because Hazur has just entered into the room. That's their belief. They place a kursi, they place a chair there. And they begin to read their durood and they say the messenger is now coming, he's now entering, everybody stand and let the messenger sit on that chair. What is that? That's not blaspheming against the messenger. Did the companions forget to put a chair inside the blessed masjid of Medina? Did they ever forget that in their life? And say that the messenger is coming now, everybody rise. That's what their belief happens to be. Likewise, you find amongst their belief, they highlight, if you celebrate the Mawlid, there will be peace and rest in a person's life. Where's the peace and rest in the blessed land of Pakistan at the moment? That's your creed. Whoever celebrates Mawlid al-Nabi, there'll be al-aman. There'll be peace and tranquility upon those people on that land. Where's the peace and tranquility in that land at the moment? That you are the great, bearing the flag of the messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You depict your belief in the sandal. What do you write in the sandal? You write the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that sandal. Even though it happens to be the sandal depicting the blessed sandal of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That sandal, when he gave it to Abu Huraira, was to show that I am the messenger. That's all it depicts. We don't need to symbolize ourselves with a sandal or kiss the sandal or to find strands of his blessed beard. At that time, if it existed, there is tabarruk, there's no doubt about that. Inside his saliva, inside his sweat, inside his remnants, it exists. But today, what proof, what evidence do you have that that which you hold today, that which you hold today is remnants of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Get a strand of his beard, start doing who, start doing dhikr. When did the Prophet Muhammad said who? When did he do that? When did he do that in his life? Turn off the lights, doing your dhikr. And then when the blessed hair begins to move, look, wawa tako, even the ball of the Hazur sallallahu alaihi wasallam begins to move as well. You foolish individuals, it's basic physics. The law of motion. If all of you begin to blow today, something, this paper will begin to move. That's what it is. But they're trying to say, look, even the hair, the strand is going in dhikr. It's moving and swaying with the dhikr. That's what they're saying, is moving with the dhikr, the blessed strand of the Prophet Muhammad. That's what their belief is. Talismans, threads. Peer Sahib, tell us what to do in Iraq. Tell us what to do in Afghanistan. You tell the world everything, don't you? Lord, get a pattern, it's on the pattern, then, isn't it? They kiss your feet, they throw their money at you, they throw flowers at you. Now you're the one that helps, you're the one that saves. A piece of matwa de pad pakana. Tell us what to do in Iraq today. Tell us what to do in Iraq today. Tell us what to do in Afghanistan today. Oh, galna chado siyasat de galnan. Leave these things, these are politics. These are politics. Your whole life has been politics. Robbing the wealth of the people and spending it on your politics. Robbing their wealth in daylight. Robbing their wealth in daylight, taking it away to your own personal causes. We've moved about with this mafia industry, moved about with them. They can't come and trick me and say you don't know anything. We lived with their sons. We lived with their gaddi nasheens. Their sons who were promised that when you come back, son, you're going to be the next Peer. You're going to be the next Sheikh. We lived with them. All night listening to Bollywood songs. Not even getting up and praying Fajr in the morning and saying, I'm going to be the next Peer. I'm going to be the next saint. I blow on people's roti chapati, give it to them. Go, you're blessed individuals. Those days are gone, and those previous saints of good individuals that existed before. That's all that their life is placed upon, these corruptions. Likewise, you find they begin to say, you don't do enough durood. You don't say no durood and no salam upon the Prophet Muhammad. Who says that? lie upon lie. Whoever does not say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bakhil, man dhukirtu indahu, falam yusalli alayhi. Aw kama qal, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the stingy one is the one that I mentioned, does not send the salutations upon me. The Quran is quite clear. Inna Allah wa malaikatu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wasallimu taslima. Oh, you believe? Indeed, Allah and His Messenger, they send their salutation greetings upon the Messenger. Oh, you believe? Send those salutations, send those greetings. Who said we don't believe in the salutation and greetings? Just because we don't stand and say, Ya Rasulallah, start shouting out the way the kayfiyah that you have. Where does that exist? Because we don't do that. But it's part of our creed. The most closest individual to the Messenger will be the one who makes the durood, who makes the salam. On Yawm al-Jum'ah, fa'akthiru alayhi salam. On the day of Yawm al-Jum'ah, send the salutations, increase the salutations. These are the false concepts they want to throw upon Ahlul Hadith. These are the false concepts they want to throw upon what they claim that we are Wahhabiyun, which is a title invented by the British colonialism at that time, upon the people who strove against them. The people who fought against them were only a certain group of individuals. And as they place this statement of anybody who goes away to dispel or to remove the concept of grave worship or stand for the truth, they're classified as a Wahhabi even to this day that we find. You claim to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fattabi'uni. Follow the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam throughout your lives. And as we mentioned, if the sunnah is complete, if Islam is complete, you don't need to add something and you don't need to take anything away. Whatever was deen yesterday has to be deen today. That's how simple it is. That's the message that we're delivering to the Muslims. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِكِ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whoever contends with the messenger of the truth has been shown to that individual and follows a path other than the way of the believers, other than the way of the companions, that individual's refuge, final destination will be none other than the hellfire.